Good evening, and welcome to the Tuesday, October 10th, 2006, meeting of Cape Elizabeth School Board. If we could start with a pledge of the allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Adjustments to the agenda.
I had one. I just wanted to add a report under policy of the wellness subcommittee. Under the policy committee.
Under policy, okay. Great. We have...
I would like to add just a brief report on communications also about safety work that we've been doing here in the system, in the building.
As item number F?
Yes.
Okay. Any other adjustments? Okay. Approval of September. That would be September 2006 school board minutes that were in our packet. Do I have a motion?
I move that we approve the September board minutes.
Thank you. Second? Trish? Any comments? All those in favor? That would be 6-0. Communications. This evening, we have a communications from Kevin regarding a PATH report.
Are we going to do that?
It's on the agenda under communications.
The PATH General Advisory Committee met 2 weeks ago to get an update on what's been going on over there. They've been working for quite a long time, probably a year and a half plus, on their own planning work, five-year plan, things like that. And they have essentially completed that work and have published the first 2 years of that. And I had intended to have copies for everyone here tonight, but they're in one of my piles on my desk. They'll show up soon.
In our mailbox.
I think there is, let's see. Oh, no, it's not. Well, I have other materials for you related to a new initiative started by Sue Gendron that requires the schools in a district to coordinate with their CTE, which for us is PATH, on the overall education of the students, not just on the technical education of the students. So PATH will be developing matrix-type systems to assist us and the other sending schools in literacy programs. I believe both Alan and I are serving on that committee. It's rather interesting, and that information will follow as well. Left everyone a calendar from PATH. For anyone who's interested, you can go through, see when our meetings are, and if you'd like to come along, or if you'd like a single one-on-one kind of tour, the administration of PATH would be happy to do that. That's pretty much it. We meet again next month. We're already starting the budget process. We'll have two meetings on the budget. And then there will be another General Advisory Committee in November.
Thank you. Item number B is a notification of intent to negotiate. We have four bargaining groups who have sent us letters dated September 13th, 18th, and 19th to request to sit down with the schools to negotiate their contracts. That would be the bus drivers, custodians, and maintenance mechanic bargaining unit, our EdTech's 2s and 3s bargaining unit, our food service employees bargaining unit, and administrative support personnel and EdTech 1's bargaining unit. We did meet prior to this evening's meeting in an executive session for this discussion, and the We are in receipt of those letters, and we'll be taking some sort of action within the 120 days, most likely after the election. Notification of resignation?
I have two notifications of resignation. The first one is from Ed Tack, and this is for your information only. This is dated September 15, 2006. The letter is from Joanne Matusko, who is resigning her Ed Tack position at Onco Elementary School because she's accepted an elementary art position at the Saco Dayton School System. Again, you don't have to vote on an Ed Tack, it's just for information's sake, and we are, at this point in time, holding that position to make decisions on what we'll do next with that. The second notification I have is of a teacher. This is Roxy Johnston. Roxy has been a special ed person in the system for several years. She has just informed us that she has accepted a position as assistant special ed director with school union number 7. And Dominic has met with her. We're working out her time of leaving. And also, again, we are leaving that position at this point in time to make some broader decisions about how it will look within the school system. I will need a vote from you to accept her resignation since she is a teacher.
So you want to do that under right now?
We can do it either. I don't know if it's is it on the agenda otherwise?
No, I don't think because
no, it
I
isn't.
See it.
Yeah, it's a fairly, it's a new one that just came.
Could we have a motion to accept the resignation of Roxy Johnston? Second? Trish? Comments? Questions? All those in favor? We wish her good luck.
Thank you.
The learning state, item number D, Maine schooling for the 21st century.
I've given each of you a copy of this latest report that has come out from the State Board of Education. If you remember last fall, we talked about that report and the initial plans for it. And was it Ann, I think, and Elaine and I went to Falmouth, I think it was, to a meeting to hear the two major authors of the report. On September 12th, this report was taken before the State Board of Education, and they have adopted this report for action. I'm not going to take you all through the entire thing, but just do want to remind you of some of the things that are in here. There is a section that talks about technology in schools. It certainly broadens the amount of technology expected and also broadens the training of teachers in order to use that technology as an adept teaching tool. It also talks about a 10-day increase in school time with half professional development and responsibilities, flexibility within this framework to adjust to the varying needs of students, differentiated contracts, including full-year contracts for teachers to respond to varied student needs, and CTE regions creating a common calendar. These are all pieces of a new plan that they're putting before the public. You'll also find on page 8 of this report the individual wireless computers, etc. And then it talks about SAU, school administrative unions, as defined by state law. And it talks about school administrative units, reducing the number of those by creating districts that serve 3,000 to 4,000 students. Recognizes the significant increase in school construction costs per square foot, and therefore looking for larger building establishments. Establishing local advisory boards, expanding the current opportunities for school choice, clearly defining school board responsibilities, and increasing average class size from 12.7 in the state to the national norm of 15.6. Under the first one, under reducing the number of SAUs, this would also look at changing the administrative unit, particularly the superintendent, from having a superintendent in every district to having area superintendents who would oversee those districts. The report goes on, and it's an interesting report. I took time this time, now that it's been finalized, to take a look at every component of the report. You also saw this past week the Brookings report, which also takes this into consideration as well. So I think what you will probably see in the next few years is some major action on the state level, at the legislative level, to make some decisions around this plan. So it's an important plan for you as board members to be well aware of. It's obviously an important plan for me as a superintendent to be well aware of as they move ahead on it. So I think it's an important report. It has been accepted, and it would be wise for you to read it. If at some point we feel like it's a report we need to discuss as action happens, we can look at that through a workshop situation.
Great. Thank you, Alan. At this point, we'd like to take a few minutes to share some communication regarding Tabor and the upcoming vote on November 7th. As most of us all know, back in June, this particular school board, we voted to not support Tabor, and since that time, there's been a lot of information out to the public, and there's been a lot of committees, and we'd like to hear a little bit about some of the committee work in Cape Elizabeth that both Kevin and Rebecca have been involved in. But I'd also like to share with you a piece that was in the paper yesterday under Maine Voices. And this was a collaborative piece done by several school board chairs, namely Betts Gorski, who is the chairman of the school board in SAD 51 Cumberland, North Yarmouth, and Marty Rubbles, who is the chairman of the Freeport School Committee. They shared this information with a variety of other school board chairs across the southern New Hampshire, southern Maine, and namely South Portland and the Cape Elizabeth School Department, along with Yarmouth, have also joined in endorsing this article. So I'd like to just take a moment to read this for the public. It's titled, Tabor Will Hit Schools Hard. The tactics it incorporates will end up thwarting sound public and educational policy. Recently, the Portland Regional Chamber of Commerce has placed such significant qualifications on its support of Tabor that its endorsement is meaningless. The Chamber concludes the proposed legislation is full of, quote, flaws and unintended consequences. One of the noted flaws, the negative impact on education, is fatal. Tabor eviscerates local control of school funding in favor of a rigid formula governing expenditures. The year-to-year change in the consumer price index as adjusted by the change in student enrollment. However, the CPI does not take into account school costs such as health insurance, changes in voter-approved debt, or federally mandated special education. Furthermore, Tabor prohibits any revenue increases with no adjustments for inflation or other factors. Tabor permits only one-third of the legislative body, a minority, to veto an override of the Tabor limits. It is naive to think services would not be affected. A five-year historical analysis of Tabor's impact on the Cumberland, North Yarmouth, Freeport and Cape Elizabeth schools show a cumulative reduction of $4.7 million for SAD 51, approximately $1.6 million from the Freeport school budget, and $7.3 million from the Cape Elizabeth school budget. Tabor also prevents the spending of additional revenues generated by an expanding economy or an increased commercial tax base if a minority says no, abolishing Maine's long tradition of majority rule. Thus, even if there was no increase in the tax rate, a minority could still prevent local investment in education. Furthermore, because all increases in revenues, including fees, must be approved by a two-thirds supermajority, parents could not pay fees for transportation, extracurriculars, or even academic subjects if one-third of the legislative body says no. In Colorado, where a less restrictive version of Tabor was implemented and later suspended, those parents who are able to pay fees to supplement the services their children access at a public school are legally permitted to do so. Those who can't don't, an abysmal public policy Maine must reject. Tabor subverts the Chamber's expressed assertion that the business climate needs a well-educated workforce to strengthen Maine's economic base. Because Tabor also subject state government to a rigid formula governing expenditures, the progress the legislature has made over the last 2 years to increase funding for education will be reversed, as it was in Colorado. In Colorado, the ratio of K through 12 teacher pay to the cost of living is the lowest in the nation. The pool of teachers here in Maine is already below the level needed to support the educational system. An even lower rate of pay will create further disincentives. In Colorado, the initiative had an even greater impact on the state's ability to fund higher education. Maine cannot tolerate this. High school graduates in Maine already access college education at one of the lowest rates in this country. Finally, the chamber recognizes that Tabor is so poorly worded that it will likely result in, quote, a protracted period of litigation, unquote. If adopted, Tabor would most likely become effective early next year. Our school budgets must be finalized in May to seek timely public approval earlier if true meaningful dialogue regarding the budget is to take place. Creating a budget in an environment of uncertainty can only result in reduced budgets with the attendant significant service reductions. While the business community may recover quickly, educational systems will not. The tactics incorporated in Tabor thwart sound public policy. They are not mere flaws and unintended consequences. Maine needs to find a solution serving both its business and educational communities, not one at the expense of another. Toby Dilworth and Eileen Alcorn, respective chairs of the Yarmouth and Portland School Committees, and Bert Edwards and Elaine Maloney, respective chairs of the South Portland and Cape Elizabeth, endorse this opinion as expressed in this column. And I think it is a good, I liked this piece. I thought it explained to people further what it really truly means for the school systems rather than the municipal and the school's budgets. So I'd like to just at this point allow some communication from some of our committee members on the work of that committee.
Just to let people know, back in late spring, early summer, the town council moved to create a task force, a Tabor task force, to look at the initiative, provide an analysis of its inner workings and what the potential impact would be in Cape Elizabeth. They invited citizens to participate, and those who attended at least two meetings would be considered members of the task force. Both myself and Kevin were working on the task force, and as of last week's meeting, the task force voted to approve the document as it stands today. However, Kevin and I, did not vote to support this document, as did Cynthia Dill and Ann Swift Kayada and several other task force members. And I'd like to just take this opportunity to explain why we did not endorse the document. A great deal of effort and work went into it. Many fair-minded, intelligent citizens were working on this document. It was quite passionate and energetic. Debates occurred. In the end, however, there were several items in the document that prevented me from endorsing it. And in particular, it was the first two question and answer paragraphs. First one is, what are Tabor's goals and the answers for that? And why was Tabor put on the Maine ballot for November 7th, which listed all of the listed specific tax statistics. And it was my belief that by placing those in the first and second positions without any additional information from the opponents, the Tabor opponent's side, the document became at that point in time a vehicle for advocacy for Tabor. And in my view, taxpayer money should not be used to publish a document that advocates in any way pro or opposing. So, in the end, my name is actually not going to be listed on the document, and neither will Kevin's or Cynthia's or Ann's or Kyle Parrish's or Joanne Morrissey's, I believe, because we did not endorse the document. So this is my effort to let people know that we did work on it, but in the end, we could not sign on with it. I don't know if Kevin has anything to add.
Well, Rebecca's really articulated this well, and I am completely able to say ditto in terms of what she's reported. I would like to go on record personally as for my reasons for not endorsing the document and/or opposing Tabor. And as Rebecca said, the document, with, by the inclusion of questions number 1 and 2, does in fact become some advocacy, more than some advocacy, for Tabor, which was not supposed to be the conclusion of an allegedly neutral committee trying to produce a neutral document. It's just impossible to sign those documents under those circumstances. There was a compromise that some of us were prepared to accept, but that just didn't happen, which doesn't surprise me when you're getting late into the evening. So regardless, the thing that bothers me the most about this is that we have been essentially banned from having our names appear on this document as having opposed it. Since we were official members of the Tabor Committee, we did attend almost all of the meetings. We participated and offered commentary when and where necessary. And to lead the public to believe that this was a unanimously approved document by leaving off our objection to it is undemocratic at best. Regardless, I continue in my opposition of Tabor because of much of the material that Elaine alluded to in the article that appeared in yesterday's Press Herald. I certainly wish you would get that because most of that never came out in the Tabor conversations, despite the best efforts of some of the members of the committee. So I am really glad that Elaine was able to join with that group and take advantage of the opportunity to publish that information. I'm going to close it at that. Frankly, I'm just about talked out on Tabor. I will continue in my assignment until the committee is disbanded. I don't know when that's going to happen, but I'm going to continue to make sure that the voice of dissent is continued to be heard at all levels in this process.
I just have a quick question. The work of that committee is not finished. There are still some other tasks that they're going to be tackling as far as what the actual effect would be if implemented. Is that not correct?
That was one of the directives given by the town council. However, as far as I can tell, as of the last meeting, there is nobody in charge of compiling that information and putting it into any sort of cohesive report or analysis. The other aspect that is being pursued is a round table, I suppose, is the right way to term it, that will have both supporters and opponents of Tabor that will be moderated by David Backer, and it's being hosted by the Thomas Memorial Library. I don't know the exact date and time of it, I apologize. October 27th, thank you. But there's lots of that's on the website. It's going to be in the Courier every edition between now and when it's going to occur. But again, as to an actual analysis of what the impact would be and what type of solutions CAPE would have to look at, I'm not sure that work is going to be done.
So it's different than the Pulaski Task Group, which did that.
Yes, I mean, this was part of the mandate of the committee, was specifically to show the impact on Cape Elizabeth. Our next meeting is not tomorrow, but the week after. Mm-hmm. I don't know how we will gather that Wednesday and then turn around, bog down the superintendent of schools, our business manager, to develop within a very short period of time the impact of Tabor on the Cape Elizabeth School Department. You know, the election is November 7th, so, you know, I don't see that physically the time is available to produce that.
Yeah, it's not so much, the time is not so much in coming up with what the impact is going to be, but what would be some of the decisions that the schools and the municipal side would be left with. That, I actually worked on the Pulaski Task Force, and that took weeks of discussion and debate. So I'm not hopeful that we're going to get this kind of information. And if we do get the information, I'm afraid we probably will be left with something that's not nearly as comprehensive as what we got with Pulaski.
Put into perspective, if you were to take an $18 million school budget as it stands currently, thereabouts, and then say a five-year historical analysis, which those figures are were developed by Pauline and Matt and some of the committee work with guidelines from the state, that shows that a five-year loss of $7.3 million out of that budget, it doesn't take too much to figure out how much, what you're going to lose in your school systems in a personnel-driven.
Yeah, when 60% of your expenses are personnel-related, it's pretty clear where a great deal of the focus is going to be. And again, you have to also remember, it's not just, you're greatly limited in your creativity to solving the problem because, as you mentioned, as it's mentioned in that Community Voices piece, if you wanted to say, okay, well, let's charge for transportation, there's a great deal of uncertainty and disagreement as to whether or not that would be allowed under Tabor or not, and whether that would have to be voted on by two-thirds of the elected body, and then a majority of our citizens. So there's not a lot of wiggle room. There's no wiggle room.
Yeah. Are there any other comments? I just have one quick announcement.
A quick one, Elaine. Okay. I think you're right on target in terms of our putting together some of our statistics. If that's not a terribly onerous job to be able to come up to that 7.3 million and then take it as a role of the board to get that information out.
Seems like
I think that would be a good way to go.
If that committee isn't going to handle that task, that we might be able to at least come up with some facts.
And actually, under the Finance Committee report, I will be mentioning a discussion that happened at our meeting regarding excuse me, the district releasing a kind of a state of the schools report, which would include kind of scenario analysis of what would happen if Tabor passes.
Okay. I just wanted to add to this regarding Tabor, some information regarding a speaker who will be at the Cumberland Town Hall on Tuesday, October 24th at 7 p.m. The woman's name is Christy Hargrove. She is the Director of Leadership for the Colorado PTA, and she will be talking about Tabor in Colorado and answering questions from the public. She is a Republican, a small business owner, parent of four children, and a PTA leader who became active in the fight to counteract the effect of Tabor. And I think there's probably a lot of people who she may be talking to the choir, but I think it would certainly help us as school board members and superintendents what might be in store or what we might be able to do to lead an effective charge against Tabor. So just share that with you. And at this point, I think we'll move on to item number F, which is communications from Alan on emergency preparedness.
I'd just like to comment on emergency preparedness fairly quickly. Certainly with the actions that have occurred in the last 2 weeks in schools across the country, including another action yesterday, there have been a lot of questions about our plans for emergency preparedness. Over the last couple of years, you've had a committee which was headed up by Mark Tinkham from the high school and John Casey from the middle school and Tom Eismeyer from Pond Cove to write and put in place an emergency plan. That plan is in place. Last year, after I got here, we reviewed those plans, had a meeting with several officials, police department, fire department, et cetera, to update it. Prior to this all happening a couple of weeks ago, I had asked John Casey to head up the committee for us this time. That committee does have a meeting on October 26th. We have a broad range of people coming into the district to take a look at our plans, to review them. Russ Webster, who is a parent in the system, also works at Logan, is going to be joining us and has reviewed the plans with us. Yesterday, I was at the office and I happened to receive an email letting me know that Homeland Security has a new grant process out and that the grants must be in by Friday. I had been in contact with each of the principals, had a list of things that they felt were necessary that were above and beyond budget. And so yesterday, I spent time putting that grant together and have worked with Pauline and Ernie and John and Neil Williams and several other people to begin to put the pieces to the puzzle so that we will be turning in a grant to Homeland Security on Friday. No guarantee that we'll get it, but one of the advantages we have is a school system. Cape Elizabeth has never requested money from Homeland Security. We've received it through the municipality for a generator, but we have not done it ourselves. So I'm hoping that some of these things will just enhance even further what's going on. I also sent a notice out to all administrators the day after the events in Pennsylvania to do a review of all of the planning with staff and when it is logical to do it based on the age of the students, to do some planning with them as well. We have been looking at, again prior to this, but we'll continue to look at practices as far as leaving buildings, evacuating buses, lockdown procedures, etc. The concern being that we, on one hand, we don't want to scare the kids to death. On the other hand, we want to be sure that everyone understands the actions that are necessary. And so we'll continue. I have been keeping updates on the website, and we'll continue to do so as we make plans and, changes. One of the questions that has come to me is, do we have a place where students are taken if we have to evacuate the campus? And at this time, I will tell you, we do have a place for each group. We do it by busing. We'll be using places like St. Bart's Church. We'll also be using South Portland High School's gym. And we are working with SMCC right now to try space also. So we are looking at places where if we do have to evacuate our entire campus, we'll be sure that those places are readily available. I've also talked to South Portland School Department about the use of buses and emergencies to help us transport students at the same time. So I think it is important for me to say publicly to the taxpayers that we are doing everything we possibly can to ensure we have the best plans in place and make sure we are guaranteeing safety as far as we possibly can in each of our schools. Thank you.
Thank you, Alan. This is a point in our agenda where we look forward to hearing from our high school and middle school students, but nobody out there looks young enough, so I would say that
we do.
Oh, my goodness. Yes, we do. I apologize.
I'm not the high school student. I wanted to introduce to the school board. This is Matt Roy. He's the president of the Matt Oaks. It's too many Matts. Okay. Rewind. This is Matt Oaks, who is the president of the SAC, the student government. Matt is not going to be, in all likelihood, the permanent representative to the school board, but the SAC hasn't decided that. They will have that in place for next month. So I talked to Matt Oaks and said, would you like to come and join us tonight? And he graciously agreed. So this is Matt Oaks.
Thank you.
As Mr. Shedd said, I didn't really have much warning of this, I was told, near the end of the day, so it's pretty informal. I just jotted down a couple highlights of what we have so far. Our football team is off to a excellent start with a 6-0, notable. Classes are running smoothly. I wrote down math team is off on a good foot after our first meet. As most of the rest of the seniors, I'm absolutely dogged down in the college application process. Mm-hmm. Ugh. Let's see, we got a new healthy-sized freshman class. I haven't personally been acquainted with much of them, but at our first SAC meeting, they were very well-voiced and well-posed, and it seems like they're going to do really well in the high school. Our renovations process has finally been completed, so we no longer have the obnoxious drilling during class, which is definitely a bonus. Talking about Tabor, the first couple weeks of school, the high school seniors and I think a couple juniors attended a debate between a couple people on either side of the issue. To keep us well informed, we're actually having another one tomorrow morning, I believe. So that's good. Let's see, at our first SAC meetings, I'm kind of going to switch to the concerns. We had a lot of complaints. The senior class especially is a little disgruntled because of some rules instated because of misbehavings of previous classes. Let's see, I feel a little unwelcome with the new policies are generating this feeling we're being pushed away from school. It's not personally all my opinions, but I'm supposed to represent the student body. So, some things, the taking away of being able to be in the senior hallway during lunch, it's an issue. And we spent a massive amount of time on discussing the dances, because that has been a huge issue this year, so we really haven't been able to tackle anything other than that. But hopefully, as Mr. Shedd said, the dances are behind us, so we'll be able to get into some real action and appoint some actual people to this committee. And I think that's about it. Just have to go off and do some homework. Thank you.
Does anyone have a question for Matt or comment? You said the dances are behind you, but you are going to have more dances.
That is Mr. Shedd and Heather Furman. That is their deal.
Okay.
There will be some continued conversation about the dances.
It's in a middle ground.
Is that right? But I think both the students and definitely many people are sort of taking breather a couple of weeks before we get back into
yeah,
that.
We have other things to talk about.
Well, I'd just like to say thank you for the students and administrators and the parents for working hard to try to provide that for the students. And it's certainly my hope that you'll continue to find a middle ground so that we can offer
Absolutely.
That to our youth.
All right, thank you.
Middle school? Steve, have they had the elections yet? Or?
Yes. We had campaign speeches Thursday last week, and the school is a moving sea of posters out there right now. And we've had elections were scheduled for Friday. We ran into a little problem by the name of technology, so that held us up just a little bit. We're having elections. We actually had elections again today. We're down to a smaller pool. We had, I think, 45 students who gave speeches on Thursday.
Wow,
so,
holy smokes.
Let's just say there were a few kids who want to be involved and have a say. When you have 7% of your student body sitting on the stage trying to cram into that space, it's interesting. But good speeches, too, well prepared. Audience was great. So we will have representatives from the middle school on board at the next school board meeting.
Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm. Be great. Look forward to that. At this point, we have comments from the public on non-agenda items, if there's anyone who would like to speak. Seeing no one, we'll move on to recognition.
Yes. The first one that I have is from the guidance office at the high school, and this is for those students for the 2007 merit program. The notice reads, High School Principal Jeff Shedd is pleased to announce this year's recipients of the 2007 National Merit Scholarship Corporation semifinalists and commended student recognitions. Over a million students entered the 2007 merit program when they were juniors by taking the PSATs, which served as an initial screen of program entrance. Fewer than 5% of these students advanced in the competition, and less than 1% of the nation's high school seniors are ultimately named semifinalists. Committed students are recognized for the exceptional academic promise demonstrated by their outstanding performance on the qualifying test. Semifinalists will continue in the competition for merit scholarship awards worth $30 million to be offered next spring. The list is as follows. For semifinalists in the 2007 merit scholarship competition, the recipients are Michael G. Katsos, did I pronounce that correctly? Daley Gruen, William Hall, A. Nathan Hendrick, Daniel F. Shedd, Liam K. Sullivan, and Catherine G. Yashua. Committed students in the 2007 Merit Scholarship Competition are Alexandra Ciraldo, Connor Dodd, Heather Furman, Allison Howe, Stannis Moody Roberts, and Mitchell D. Wright. And we congratulate all of those students for representing Cape Elizabeth High School so well. I also have a second piece from Jeff also. The first issue is the boys' cross-country team. You remember at your last meeting, you approved the boys' cross-country team to go to California to participate. They took 23rd place overall at Stanford. Now, what is important to realize is this is an invitational track meet that out of the more than 160 invited teams from across the country, they were 23rd and were competing in a level above their own level here. Our team was introduced to as the team from Cape Elizabeth High School with the highest SATs in the state of Maine. Interesting introduction. But I understand from everyone I've talked to, it was an amazing trip. The kids did a great job. I think their coach, Mr. Weatherby, came back very excited because of the opportunity that these young people had. I also will mention that at the Manchester, New Hampshire Invitational Cross Country Meet, the boys took fifth place in the elite division. The girls' team finished second in the small schools division. I have one last one that came in today, and so I didn't get it in your pack. This is from Marguerite Lawler Rohner, who is the art teacher at the middle school. She notes we have our students' artwork currently on exhibit at the Maine Department of Education. 48 works of art are set up in Augusta. The works were delivered in for an October exhibition, which will remain up for the month. Seventh graders sent up observational drawings of shells, and the fifth graders sent up tempera landscape paintings. Each student who participated in this exhibit will receive a certificate signed by Commissioner Gendron. And those are the announcements I have, but very positive ones. Do I have another one? Yes, thank you. I almost missed this one. Another announcement, a more personal announcement. This is from one of our kindergarten teachers, Nicole Ball, who is letting us know that she will be seeking a leave of absence because of her pregnancy from March 12th to April 23rd, date subject to possible change, obviously. And planning to take the assigned 6 weeks and return to school to finish out the school year. I laughed when I first heard from Nicole because it was like the next day after we hired a half-time kindergarten teacher for the half-time position. I said, let's not announce this too quickly so that it doesn't cause too much of a disruption. But she again does not need to get the permission. It's just an informational piece to let you know that that will be happening. Thank you for reminding me of that.
Thank you.
That's all.
All right. At this point, we'd love to hear superintendent's report.
The one and only report I have for this evening is on The View, which is our local newspaper. Last year we did one view, and it was a fairly long, extensive view. I think it was well received. But after meeting with the communications committee, after talking with people in the district, what we decided to do was two views. They would be shorter. One to come out in October, and the other one to come out early spring. The newest one is almost ready. We received quite a few articles. As a matter of fact, I see Ted Jordan sitting there. Ted was very good to go get some of his former students who worked on the interviews last year for the Liberty Ship people, and they have sent some very interesting comments. We've tried to make all of the reports this time very classroom student focused, and so what you will see is articles like that. We have a couple more articles to finish up, and hopefully we'll have that to Patty so that she can get it ready and get it out sometime by the end of next week. So I'm real pleased to see that, and then we will be looking at another one, as I said, in early spring, to kind of look at where we are at that point. Thank you.
Along with this, in the superintendent's report, could you just update us a little bit on the high school project?
Yes.
And the final counting that may need to be done?
You had asked me about that earlier. We are at the stage right now where, as a reporter said, from the school, we are pretty well finished. Not completely, there are a few last-minute things that need to be done. We closed the books with a construction company, we received their final check. We have two or three things in waiting that we need to deal with. The first of them is some problems with the carpet at the high school in the library, which we'll be dealing with. From there, we also have outside lights, outside cameras for protection, and we also have a washer and dryer issue that will be discussed as far as the money is concerned. We also have set aside, based on a meeting of the committee earlier this year, we have set aside $15,000 towards the light at the top of the driveway coming out of the high school. As many of you know, the planned project to build a Dunkin' Donuts has put on hold. I'm not hearing it's ended, but it's been put on hold, which I understand from the town manager means that the plan for lighting has also been put on hold because they were going to pay a part of that. He's been very clear, as with town councilors, as well as a couple of parents who've written letters to say it is on hold. It does not mean it's ended at this point in time. So we have that $15,000 held. Interest from the account has also been used towards that, and the money that is left will take care of the last two or three things that need to be done. We first need to look at the carpeting and take care of that, and then we'll move on to the other two issues to finalize those. So we should have a final, I hate to say final, we will have a report for the November meeting, but we still may have some expenses waiting to make some decisions on how we're going to do those last few things. The only other thing I would say is if you haven't been down to visit the high school, please do that. It really looks nice. They have really worked hard at getting it cleaned, getting the painting done, et cetera, and so the school is really looking very nice. We do have, at this point, a plan eventually to have an open house for the community. We have set that back a ways until we get the decisions on what we're going to do with the carpeting and then to make some plans from there. So the original plan to have late September, early October has been put off for a while until that job can be completed. Thank you.
May I ask a question?
Yes.
There is, in the town council agenda, they're going to be voting on some changes. Yes. To the access road to the high school. I was wondering if you could clarify what those are.
I did. As a matter of fact, I think you were the one who emailed me first. I had seen it. Michael has been away, so I wasn't able to talk with him. But Mary did some checking for me, and we did some investigation. What we have found out is that is taking care of some old ordinance plans that used to be there about one-way drives, and so it's just changing that. It doesn't have anything to do with the lighting itself, is our understanding at this point in time.
Thank you.
Could I just make one more comment,
oh,
if I could? I just was sitting here thinking about it. This evening, one of the things that we're going to give to all of you is a new policy book. Unfortunately, because we have copiers that whenever you're doing something like that die on us, we have not been able to finish it. So it will be done in the next couple of days as soon as we have toner. But I would just like to take a few minutes to comment on the fact that the job that's being done with that is an enormous job. The policy committee has worked hard over the last few years to put policy together, but I would say to you also that I have watched my administrative secretary work many, many hours, including many hours this weekend, which are not paid hours, to come in and do that work. It is an enormous task. Policy manuals are enormous tasks for every system, no matter where you are, but besides getting the policies corrected, making sure they reflect correctly in the books, we have also been working to get them on the website so that they're much more readily available. But I would like to thank the policy committee for all the work they are doing. I can't say it's done because it'll probably go on forever, but I'd also like to say a very special thank you to Mary Bruns, who has really given way, way above the hours to get this book done, and I thank her very much.
Yeah. I'd like my six-year-old grandson for coming and helping
yeah.
me.
Yes, her six-year-old grandson helped you this week.
Must have loved that stapler. Thank you. At this point, we are going to welcome Ted Jordan and Evan Thayer for a school report on the future of schools.
Evan and I are very pleased to come tonight to report to you all what we were lucky enough to share a few Fridays ago. The theme or the title of the seminar we went to was Driven by a Common Vision. I'm going to report on the part about Robert Reich, the former Secretary of Labor, who talked more on a macro picture about the national economy and what the national education means to the national economy. And then Evan's going to follow up and talk more in terms of what Charles Lawton and Colleen Quint said that day about Maine economy and Maine education. And for me as an economics teacher, it was a gold mine of information. It was so I'm going to try to share with you tonight about the education implications, but if I go off on a tangent, Elaine, I'm hoping you'll rein me back in, because I could talk at length about this and would love to. But briefly, former Secretary of Labor Robert Reich talked about three trends, or three vectors as he described it, one being globalization. It sounded a lot like what you probably have heard in terms of Thomas Friedman's book, The World is Flat, about how the world has changed the last decade or so or more. And some of the things that Robert Reich brought to our attention is, again, U.S. products are supplied by a global supply chain, and the misperception is often that, therefore, thinking of India and China, we're going to the cheapest source. He pointed out that it's becoming more important to source where it can be done best as well as inexpensively. He said, this means that our standard of living is going to depend upon an increasingly integrated global economy. And he talked about how standard measurements are international trade. What's our trade deficit? And he relayed a very funny story to try to make the point that it's really impossible to tell. Who is us, who is them in this international trade. A few years ago, Robert Reich had his hips replaced and had him done at Brigham Hospital in Massachusetts. And shortly after that, he said he wanted to find, of course he's an economist, he wanted to find out where they were made, and he talked about, you know, he was wondering what his new nationality would be. And after a lot of research, he found out that they were designed in Germany and produced in France. And he jokingly said he had to refer to them as Liberty Hips for a while, given the political climate. But his point was, France and Germany are not areas where there is inexpensive labor. And he connected it back to Maine by saying, we have to go with, what companies will go with in the future is where things are made the best, as well as the price, the cost considerations. The second vector he talked about was technological change, and he talked about the great improvements to our lives because of technological change, and he said that it has caused some changes, and he referred to the fact that we used to have bank tellers, and we used to have telephone operators, and there used to be something called a service station with actual human beings and uniforms. So, you know, not to sound like a Luddite, but he did say that the changes in technology, the improvements in our efficiency have been very good for us, but it has come at a cost. And he, again, connected it back to what I'm the point I think Evan and I will make tonight is that most new jobs today are in the local service economy. He talked about retail and restaurant, hospital, childcare, elder care, hotels and construction, and that those jobs really don't pay very much. He did make the point, though, that in this 21st century economy, good education and good connections will work well together. Those people who are neither well educated nor well connected are going to have a tough time. But for people who do, and of course that applies to us and our graduates, it will work very well. His last vector, his last trend that he talked about was demographics. And of course the main point there was, well, I think what we all know is that the baby boomers are retiring soon. And it's true especially for Maine, that our economy, if you look at a study of our demographics, our state is one of the oldest in the nation. And he talked about some of the implications of that. He then brought it all back together and said that as more and more of us retire, What will the workforce look like, and will they be able to support the baby boomers who are retired? And he talked about, he's not suggesting everyone needs a four-year college education, but we need to improve our education. He talked a lot about two-year colleges, community colleges, vocational schools, and discussed that the new middle class in the 21st century is going to be comprised of technicians. He mentioned lab techs, mechanical techs, computer techs. Those are the people who are going to be key in our economy, and they'll need to install and maintain these systems. I think I'll turn now and let Evan talk to you about what Charles Lawton and Colleen Quinn said, and then maybe we can tie it back together as we get towards the end of it.
I too very much appreciated the opportunity to go to this conference. Chuck Lawton is a Maine economist. I've actually followed his articles. He publishes an article every Sunday in the paper called The Bottom Line. But he often ties education to economy, to the economy. And I think that's important for us to view it in those terms at times. I originally started out having Colleen Quint. She's the executive director for Senator George Mitchell's Scholarship Research Institute. And then Charles Lawton, who's the economist I just spoke of, I had their comments separate, and then I kind of put them into one. So you'll hear me blur the lines here a little bit in the interest of brevity. But the key question is, in Maine, are we adequately preparing students for what they'll face in the 21st century? Either the state of Maine or through the Mitchell Institute, they conducted a survey a number of years ago called Barriers. And one of their findings was the following. Of 100 students in Maine that enter high school as freshmen, 76 will graduate from high school 4 years later. Of that 76, 41 then go on to college. And only half of those complete college. So of 100 freshmen, you end up getting 21 in the state of Maine with a college degree. The challenges could be financial for these folks. The challenges could be not valuing education, perhaps. And they're currently planning on embarking on a Barriers 2 study to look at exactly that as we look at how to prepare folks for this technology-driven 21st century. On the business front, a lot of changes as well over the last half century. It used to be 60% of Maine jobs were blue-collar. We're down now to 25. White-collar jobs have multiplied by 2. And sales and service jobs have also increased. Chuck Lawton had some interesting data on income, and a lot of times you'll hear that our earnings per capita are keeping in line as a percent of national average. I think we're somewhere around 90% of national average for our earnings per capita. But our earnings per worker has actually been falling behind recently, so it was good to see that made clear for us. Looking ahead, Chuck Lawton said, had a nice phrase, he said, the new mill in Maine is probably going to be the hospital, and that medical careers of all types are going to be increasing dramatically. They had some figure of, I forget the time period, but 25,000 new jobs in healthcare are anticipated in the state of Maine in some future time period. Financial services also and education will also be an industry for Maine. These fastest growing sectors will require increased levels of education. And how do we address this? My ears perked up most when they spoke about how education needs to address these business concerns. So I'll just dive in there. And I'll give you two examples of what Colleen Quint mentioned in terms of campaigns that the state of Maine and or her institute are looking at to help with this. One is called the Readiness Campaign. What they found is that students that are attend Maine colleges that also have jobs or job experiences in Maine at that time have a higher likelihood of staying in Maine. And so what they're looking to do is develop programs where they find students in college junior or senior year and give them job experiences so that they're more likely to stay here when they graduate. The other campaign I would highlight is called the Kickstart Campaign, where they're actually digging deeper down into the eighth grade level across Maine. They're looking at the importance of that 8th to 9th grade transition for students and making sure not to say, you know, you need to start thinking about jobs per se, but to make sure that those folks in the 8th to 9th grade transition appreciate and value an opportunity to get a good education and realize the need for that. One other interesting exchange was during the question and answer session. Again, this conference was largely driven by business folks, so a lot of the attendees were business people. And they were commenting on the fact that oftentimes educators might come in and say, what are the skills that we're going to need? And the business folks might say, you know, we can teach them a lot. What we need is people that are communicative, that can work without supervision, that take pride in their work, and that can anticipate problems. And over the course of the next minute or so, we realized that was about 2 degrees of separation from the problem-solving skills that we often talk about in education. And that is what is critical. Colleen Quint's final thoughts were she's intrigued by, in the last 5 or 6 years, the changes in the state legislature in terms of their understanding of the what she called the inexplicable link between education and economy in this area. 6 years ago, it was thought these were mutually exclusive, but they now do understand that they go hand in hand. Chuck Lawton's final word on this was, you know, what are we going to need to attract people to the state of Maine and to get them to stay in the state of Maine? We've got an aging population, as Ted mentioned. We are losing our younger population at a rate that exceeds significantly the national averages for younger aged people. What are we going to do to attract them? He feels that the answer is business already that's in Maine. Maine is a small business state, largely, and that we need to support an environment for them where they can grow their small business into something larger. Production will not be chased to the lowest cost if we stay cutting edge in innovation in Maine and if our quality of life remains high, which is not only the natural beauty of Maine, the low congestion, maintain our good schools, but also provide an attractive environment for new businesses to locate here. I guess that's where I would pause. It's a phenomenal conference. Difficult job to condense a half-day conference into 5 minutes. I guess we would ask if you had any questions of us that we could help make clear.
I'm just curious, when the business leaders talked about what they're looking for in graduates, and they mentioned things as communication skills, working without supervision, problem solving, did any of them then reflect on the new assessment environment that we are in and whether that actually is gauging what they need in their employees?
A comment that Robert Reich made sticks in my mind, and he was a product of the New York Regents exams, and so he values that as a measure of whether the citizens of New York are getting value for their investment. So he appreciated that. At the same time, he said that he fears that we are testing students to death, and that the culture that we need to create is one of innovation and idea making. And Robert Reich was questioning the consistency of that with the test environment that we may be taking on. That's my answer to that question. Yeah.
So that was Robert Reich, but what did any of the business leaders seize on that? Because, you know, he's not necessarily the more conservative business leader population.
I don't recall any other specific comments. I was left with the impression a few times about that idea of problem solving being key. I can't say there were other specific comments about our testing system.
The only thing I would add is, you know, we're mindful that we're speaking to a school board and not like the employers, people who are employing people for the state of Maine. I thought we talked at length about this on the ride home and then the subsequent week and a half since then. And we've talked to Mr. Shedd and people in the guidance department at the high school. This is more, I think, worrisome for other parts of Maine. I think as far as our school system is going, we're doing phenomenal. You can look at our school profile on the Cape Elizabeth School Department website, and you can see, and I'm sure you folks are aware of it, people at home can see, that our students are getting into many of the best four-year colleges, and there are students getting into some of the local colleges as well. The one thing I would ask you to consider, and I brought copies of the last one we did here, we did a survey of the classes, of the alumni of the classes of 1996 through 2000, in the spring of 2001, so that's a little more than 5 years ago. And again, it's probably been some time, so I'm not sure if everyone here has seen that report. But based upon what we were doing during those 4 years, again, our students have done very well in college. Their GPA is very high. 83% of them finished at the same college they started at, and I think that's unheard of in other parts of the state and other parts of the country. There hasn't been, to my knowledge, any formal study of our alumni since the spring of 2001. So that might be something that we should think about. You know, I can give you some anecdotal information. I keep in pretty good touch with many of the alumni, and you know, one of the questions I always ask in my emails or when I see them when they're home at Christmas time is, how well prepared were you for school? And the answer is always very well. I think we're doing very well there. But I think it would behoove us, you know, as we move into this 21st century, given Robert Reich's comments, Mr. Lawton and Ms. Quinn's comments, to think about all aspects of our community.
I was just wondering, what are the opportunities to continue some of these discussions here in our own school community? Because it sounds like, you know, it's a really thought-provoking conference. So where do you take that here?
For myself, I don't know if it's discussion or action. As I think about how to pursue. I've been fortunate enough to start up and work on an extracurricular activity, the robotics program. That what intrigues me about it, and was one of the reasons why I wanted to attend this, is that I see a multitude and a diversity of students drawn to that activity. Folks that will be great at a two-year community college, folks that might go on to get their PhDs in some type of engineering discipline. So for myself personally, I'd like to reach out a little bit too. Perhaps community colleges or other local universities here. I know USM is in its first year of a mechanical engineering program. They're doing video links to Orono. I heard the call from here to do more with getting students, giving them a window into the workplace. And so I would just like to develop some of those connections informally, perhaps, but then maybe that would lead to other things.
Well, I guess really my question might be more to Jeff in terms of when any of our staff goes to, you know, a conference, is there, you know, how does information sharing, I mean, we can only send, you know, a few people to programs like these, at staff meetings. I mean, I'm just kind of curious how, you know, other folks get to benefit from the day that you all spent.
I would say through department meetings as well as faculty meetings, we will pass these on.
And this is a bit of a different conference in some ways, because it's a very sort of big picture conference as opposed to talking about teaching strategies in math or social studies or that sort of thing. And so those kinds of conferences, which is most of what our teachers go to, are shared largely within the departments, within the people who have a particular reason to know. I mean, I think that Evan and Ted and I can sit down and talk about how do these ideas get shared with the entire faculty, and I think the idea of doing it at faculty meetings and sort of, I mean, and it sort of connects to some of the messages that they brought back from that conference. Actually, I think connect fairly well with some of the comments that were in our NEAS report. They're not the ones that we've tackled yet, because we're taking the time to deal with curriculum as the front burner issue. But they actually deal quite directly. They overlap quite directly with some of the things that I mentioned in terms of our school mission, in which we say that we really value problem-solving skills, and how do we measure that, and how do we see that, what does that look like? We say we want to prepare kids for post-secondary, not just classic four-year education, but a variety of opportunities that they may have there. And I think the NEAS reports make some comments about that as well. So I think that there's a tremendous amount of overlap in probably the second part of the year that we can begin to make some of those connections between that critical document that's already on the table.
That's helpful. Thanks, Jeff.
I just wanted to
Ann sort of started this thought process. First, I wanted to thank you for coming because it was great, but my question sort of builds on Ann. Those skills that you're mentioning are things that you sort of see when you track your alumni, you have immediate feedback. But some of those things are important to the middle school and to the at Pond Cove where you're starting to build those skills. You've kind of answered it at the high school. I mean, this little presentation in and of itself would be great to have at the other schools as well, sort of share that information. It's either reinforcing, I know the assessment and the work that's done has sort of made people look at how they do things differently, but it will either reinforce some of the decisions they've made through that process or say, hey, maybe we should be doing something a little bit differently. I think it's great information to know all the way through the system.
As a system, K through 12, we usually get together at least once a year. In the past, at least the past 4 or 5 years, has been driven by the main learning results, you know, the whole focus of our one day together. But I think it's a great idea for the future.
I think another commitment we can make to this also is, I didn't realize they had been to this until they contacted me the other day, but there's been a lot of discussion amongst administrators about what's happening out there. Dominic has brought some readings that he has been doing, as a matter of fact, is reporting them in our local newspaper as well. But I think one of the things that we as a system, Cape Elizabeth, but you can say this in any town, is we are having to take a look at how we educate young people today, because it isn't the same, or it shouldn't be the same as what we did 30 years ago. So I think your question, Ian, and I think your question, Tricia, are very important as we begin to take a look at where we're going. And part of that comes out of the curriculum building, the assessment system, and looking at how we actually instruct and how we change instruction to meet the picture of young people who are going to be the adults of the mid-21st century. And those are discussions that we're having with our administrative team that we are going to be carrying out as we reactivate a curriculum process and assessment process as well.
In terms of awareness of it, I know that many of our students are aware of it through the various speakers that come into our classrooms. We're lucky enough that the local Chamber of Commerce sponsors a group of our students to go to the monthly Egg and Issues, and I'm telling you, the things we heard from these three economists that day, we have heard from former Governor King and Mr. Barber of Barber Foods and other speakers over the last couple of years. In terms of the practical application, the last 3 weeks of the seniors' time with us is their senior transition projects. And in many cases, they are out doing job shadowing, and they're beginning, if they haven't got it already, beginning to hopefully have it reinforced. Those skills that Evan referred to later are what's important for the 21st century, for getting a job.
And Trish, just also to advocate for something that Evan's been trying to do at the middle school, I'll take this opportunity to make a plug for him, is I saw that you're trying to recruit people to become robotics coaches or something like that at the middle school. I know he's very intent on getting that program really up and running. So I think you can see here it kind of making its way through K through 12. I know that my son, who was a first grader last year, enjoyed Evan's summer program and just fell madly in love. So I'm waiting to see it being offered at Pond Cove. And my only little side request is, see if you can really reach out to women coaches and girls in the curriculum, because my daughter was intrigued yet intimidated at all the boys that were in the room.
Fair enough.
Great.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Unfinished business. Policies for second reading. Anne?
We have two policies. The first is IKE, which is student progress through the grades. We looked at this last month for first reading, and what's presented here tonight in your packet has no changes from that. So I'd like to make a motion that we adopt this policy IKE as presented here tonight.
Second.
Thank you, Rebecca. I'm sorry. Are there any questions regarding this policy? Comments? All those in favor? 6-0.
Okay, the second one is IHOA. This is the student travel and field trips policy that we have discussed for quite some time, and we've brought it before the board for a first reading. There have been some changes, and so what you see here includes those changes in red, or things that have been struck from the first reading. I do want to bring your attention to page 4. There are actually two changes that didn't make it into here. We, you know, again, Mary, we've given her so many different copies. So somehow there were two changes that probably didn't make it into this final one that we wanted to have changed. But under transportation, the second paragraph, we wanted to take out, instead of all in-state trips, it's just all trips, so to strike the in-state. And then I also believe, but other committee members can correct me if I'm wrong, I believe that we also took out a couple sentences down with six or fewer students. We were not going to, that pertained to an older policy that had to do with size of vehicles and so forth. So I believe that we were taking that out, so also strike just that and leave the rest of that sentence as is. Other than that, all of the other changes that our committee has discussed in great detail are presented here. So I'd like to move that the board adopt policy IHOA as presented here with the changes that are in red, in addition to the changes that I've just spoken of on page 4 under transportation.
So moved.
Thank you, Trish. Is there a second? Becca? Any discussion?
Congratulations. Congratulations to us all.
This was a tough one, but I think this is thorough, and if there's no other questions, comments, all those in favor? 6-0.
I do want to thank Jeff. He spent a lot of time researching a lot of different things. And, you know, I would like to just comment. It's not really in here, but one of the things that has changed is that our school buses are now going to be traveling out of state for trips, which is a change. And one of the impacts that that will have is that it will help to keep costs down for out-of-state travel, which I think is a great thing. And I want to thank Sue Weatherby for her help. That does entail a fair amount of paperwork for each and every one of our school buses. And I want to thank Pauline for helping to look into and help us to understand the different issues related to that. So I think that'll be a positive change.
Great. New business. We have item number A, consideration of the superintendent's recommendations for athletic fee positions for fall 2006.
We have one sheet from Scott Labby at the middle school for two new coaching nominations. The first is David Shields for middle school football, and the second one is Anthony Delaquella for our middle school football assistant. Those are the only two athletic ones I have.
Okay. Do I have a motion to accept the superintendent's recommendation?
So moved.
Thank you, Rebecca. Second. Trish? Comments? All those in favor? 6-0. Item number B, consideration of the superintendent's recommendations for co-curricular fee positions for the 06-07 year.
I have an extremely long list here. Would you like me to read it all the way through?
I think that would be fine unless someone would like to separate them out.
So just go right straight through?
Right through.
Okay, for the high school, I have the yearbook. There are three people in that. Rachel Guthrie, excuse me, will be halftime. Jeannie Harmon, who will be quarter time. And Joanne Moriarty, who will be quarter time. Student government is Sean Garrett half and Brandy LaPointe half. Theater technical is Peter Bloom. Theater costume is Deb Riccio. Health phys ed department chair is Scott Shea. CAT chair is Belinda Snell. CAT members are Sharon Merrill, Brenda LaPointe, David Peary, Paula Harris, Kitty, Lisa, and Ben Raymond.
Freshman class advisor is Susan Garrett, and those are the ones for the high school. For the middle school, eighth grade SAT representative is Paul Casey. Co-curriculars of drama are Deborah Keefe and Kathleen Heenan Tuttle. Seventh grade SAT representative is Deb Casey. Co-directors of the fifth and sixth grade math team are Allison Caruso and Adam Killip. Civil rights team advisor is Kim Sturgeon, and the student council is Jim Dolliner. For system-wide, mentors for new teachers, it's Aaron Filio for Pierre Parity, Lisa Leonard for Christina Moniz, Matt Whaley for Adam Killip, Marie Hayes for Gina Rossi, Janet Amberger for Lisa Derman, Linda Paul for Nicole Ball, Lynn Spadinger for Marianne Harrington, Susan Safer for Morgan Burns, Michael Efron for Sharon Dorsey, Joel Schroeder for Tom Shahey, Kathy Hamlin for Lori Sylvester, Kathy Hamlin also for Rob Thompson, and Hannah Jones for Lisa Melanson. That is the list that I have.
Okay, thank you. Do I have a motion to accept the superintendent's recommendations?
Do you have?
One adjustment to make that I noticed on the middle school list, where it says one name for a student council advisor. There are actually two advisors. Joe Doan is the second name.
Joe Doan?
Yes.
Okay.
Right. With the addition of Joe Doan to the student council with Jim Dolliner at the middle school, is there a motion to accept the superintendent's recommendations?
So moved.
Thank you, Ann. A second. Linda? And any further questions? All those in favor? 6-0. Consideration of policies for the first reading. Ann?
The first one is policy IKF, which is graduation requirements. And it's not done in red with strikes and all that stuff because it's pretty much rewritten, although it stays essentially the same number of credits. It's just kind of rewritten. Jeff, do you want to speak to any of it? I mean, there's not really significant changes. More than anything, the format has changed, and it goes from talking about courses to specific numbers of credits. But Jeff, if you'd like to speak to that.
I was looking at something else, so I'm trying to find the draft. There are only two substantive changes, I think. There's a little bit of formatting change, but the two substantive changes both would affect graduating classes who begin attending the high school starting next year. And one is, okay, I've got it for me. Okay, one is under science, it says the requirement would be 30 credits, which it is right now. That's not a change. The change is, it says, beginning with the class of 2011, which is this year's eighth graders, when they arrive at the high school next year as ninth graders, those credits must be in the areas of physics, chemistry, and biology. Our sequence of courses is physics, chemistry, and biology in the 9th, 10th, and 11th grades, and all the students take those courses. A very tiny percentage of those kids do not do well in those courses. And so what this is, and this is partly a reflection of the learning results, but partly a reflection of the fact that these courses build on one another. It's just to say that you can't substitute another elective course in the sciences for one of these core courses. So that's what that's all about. It has virtually no impact on 97% of our students. It has a little bit of impact on some starting with ninth graders next year. There's a similar change that we're recommending, and I should also say that change, it still remains very unclear what's happening with the main learning results, but whatever happens with the main learning results, I'm sure that physics, chemistry, and biology will be core requirements, and this will reflect that as well, though that's not the driving impetus behind it. The second change is a similar change, and it has to do with social studies. is a requirement of 30 credits. That's not new. That's how many credits are now required of students in order to graduate, of which 10 must be earned in U.S. history and 5 credits must be earned in U.S. government. That is also not new. That's been the law for many, many years. But what it does do is it would say that beginning with this, with next year's ninth graders again, this year's eighth graders, 15 additional credits must be earned in courses in world history. And that's consistent, again, with the way our kids are assigned. And if you asked virtually all of our kids, they would say that World History 1 and World History 2, which are a semester course in the freshman year and a year-long course in the sophomore year, they think they're required anyway. They all are required to take them. It will have a very minor impact, but again, it's getting at the issue of these courses build one to the other. There are connections between world history that are then built in when students move on to U.S. history. And so students ought not to be able to bypass those requirements and take some other valuable social studies classes, but not the same foundation that are kind of connected together in a coherent sequence. Those are the only two substantive changes that are recommended in this policy. Thank you.
So are there any other thoughts or questions on this?
One little typo. In the last sentence, for students who transfer to Cape Elizabeth, I think we need to insert the word "the" before principal. It doesn't read properly.
Okay. Okay. Thanks. So this will go back to the policy committee, and then it will come back here for a second reading next month. The next policy is IMBB, which is accommodation of sincere beliefs of required instruction. And this basically has to do with if a parent takes issue with any course conduct that runs contrary to their personal belief system.
My only comment is I think we want to insert Cape Elizabeth.
Right. First paragraph.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Any other thoughts or comments on that? Okay, so then this will come back in the same form for a second reading next month. And then the last one is IMG, Animals in Schools. The one change that the committee is recommending is what you see in red, the third paragraph. Do yours have that in red?
Yeah.
Any questions or thoughts on that?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Item number D is the consideration of the superintendent's nomination to a 0.5 kindergarten teacher position.
As you remember, as school opened this year, our numbers in the kindergarten were higher than expected. So one of the things we did was open a half-time position. Interestingly, we had quite a few applications for that position. And checked candidates very carefully, and Martha Olive, who was working in, I just forgot where it was, Falmouth, has come to us to take over that half-time position. I've had the chance to meet with her, as has Tom. She's a real go-getter and very excited about being there, and I think you'll find he'll do an excellent job with that half-time position. That half-time position is looked at as a one-year position to be looked at again in the spring as we begin the transition. So I nominate Martha Hall.
Do I have a second? I
move that we accept our superintendent's recommendation for the half-time kindergarten teacher.
Thank you. Now I'd like a second. Linda, thank you. Any questions for Alan regarding this recommendation? Seeing none, all those in favor? 6-0. Thank you, Alan. A consideration of recommendations from the Personnel Committee. We have in our packet job descriptions for the Food Service Director and for the Achievement Center Coordinator. And also a information on the summary on the superintendent's evaluation. This would be the evaluation process. So there's been some considerable work on the part of the Personnel Committee. Does anyone want to speak to that, or?
Kathy asked me to take care of that.
All right, thank you.
I mean, the documents are what they are. And the one that I think requires the closest attention, of course, is the superintendent's evaluation. That's really not much more to say on the top.
I have a question regarding job descriptions, food service director.
Sure.
In the job goal, it says to provide each student with food of high nutritious quality in the atmosphere of cleanliness, cheerfulness, and personal caring. That sounds great. I'm just wondering why, under performance responsibilities, we don't have something that specifically addresses nutritious quality in a lunch menu.
That's a real good question. Pauline, do you want to tackle that one?
I think we may not have a specific performance responsibility that deals with that, but the overall goal of the position is to provide nutritionist meals to our student. If somebody wants to add something to this job description, we can bring it back to the Personnel Committee.
Given the new policy that's been required from the federal and state level, I think it would be appropriate to have that included as a performance responsibility.
On behalf of the committee, I'll take that back to the committee. And if you would send me an email, or Kathy directly an email, stating your thoughts on that,
okay,
we can certainly get that taken into consideration.
Okay. At that, Trish, go ahead.
Going through the performance responsibilities, it's a little concerning, particularly in light of one of the auditor's comments in the reports that we got. There's not a lot of segregation of duties in some of these. I don't know if this is the area where it needs to be discussed in terms of job description or how we handle that from an operational standpoint.
I think everyone on the committee recognizes the issue about segregation of duties, particularly as related to those that have a fiscal impact. We're suffering the same problem here that we suffered in every company I ever worked for, and that was not enough staff to do that. If you feel that's important, I would certainly, again, be willing to table this and bring it back to the committee along with your thoughts on the matter.
I mean, I'm definitely sensitive that even in the auditor made that comment, but I mean, even if there was some other existing staff person who might take one of these responsibilities.
Just for the record, I don't disagree with you at all. That auditor's comment, Pauline, would you correct me if I'm wrong, has been in there every year? Ad nauseum? Yes.
So that doesn't mean we should ignore it.
No.
Having once in a previous life written a lot of those auditor's comments. And I understand that. I guess I would just request that perhaps we take a second look.
Certainly.
No, I just have a question. Pauline, I remember we discussed this before. Our problem is, though, the amount of staffing we have. Am I correct as far as the audit process?
Yes, it is.
Yes, that's what I thought. So to take it back, to add it in, will also require some discussion about how we will cover that with the staff as it stands right now. Okay. I just wanted to be sure that I remembered that correctly.
Well, you know, and that may wind up being the focus of our conversation, yep, is how do we pull this off with the existing staff and see whether or not there's options. But we'll certainly, once again, on behalf of the committee, I'll bring it back for our next meeting, which I believe is coming up pretty shortly.
Thank you. Could I also just make a suggestion as to the responsibilities that the food service director serve as a member of the wellness committee? That's going to come out of the new legislation, that there be a wellness committee.
Yep.
So I think that would be one role that we had talked about, the food service director being a member of that committee.
The policy as it stands right now is it's going to be up to the discretion of the superintendent, but I can't imagine that he would want the food service director not to be on that committee,
yeah,
so.
That's my only conflict in putting that into the job description, because we already have, you know, or to almost have a policy stating that that's being left up to the superintendent.
Intendant, okay.
But I do think, I think the comment is accurate, though, that you do want that person on that committee, so yeah. I don't see a problem with having that on the position.
As long as you have no problem, yeah. I can certainly add that.
An expectation, okay.
Is he coming to beat us?
No, he's coming to beat me. I'm not yelling, so nobody can hear me.
Are there any other comments on two job descriptions and the superintendent's evaluation report? I do think that...
Did you just say, and the superintendent evaluation process? Or did
evaluation reports, not
reports.
The report.
Okay.
We do not have the report at this point, but we do need to schedule that.
The process, you mean?
This is the process. This is the
Those are the reports that have been issued, or the results of information gathering, but it's not really descriptive of a process.
Did
That's
this,
my problem. I don't actually see a description of the process, so I don't even know what the process is.
And that when the personnel committee met, Kevin, this packet here is reflective of the initial evaluation tool that we used. Was there any discussion as to this being continued to be used for the final 18-month report?
Well, we had quite a long discussion as far as using the existing form that Alan had presented and had presented to members of the administration and received feedback from them. Going forward, using the same format for his evaluation. All of our discussion in committee centered around what type of form we wanted to use, if we wanted to add some kind of grading system to the form that Alan had provided. He more or less provided us copies of the comments he has received to date mm-hmm. to go along with the form.
Yeah, we received that.
And that's why it was enclosed in the packet, just to make sure, again, that everybody had a copy of it. It was the recommendation from the personnel committee to go forward using this form without any type of grading system being added to it. We, as the board, doing his evaluation.
How does this compare with previous superintendent evaluation forms used by the board?
I do recall one of the other items that we would use would be an opportunity to poll, so to speak, one-third of the employees in the district each year. So on a three-year cycle, there'd be an opportunity for every teacher or staff member to give some feedback regarding the superintendent's performance. And then that would be compiled for the school board and presented during the final evaluation tool.
And the personnel committee's recommendation does not include a poll of staff at this time in view of the significant change agent role that Alan has played in this initial year and a half year. So that's not part of our recommendation.
It's not, you don't feel that the board would like to hear from the teachers?
No, we're talking about the entire, all employees.
Well, for example, this year, to hear from one-third of the staff not just the DLT, which we have here in the packet.
I do have that right, don't I?
Correct.
Yeah, okay. No, that's the recommendation.
And so, I'm sorry, could you explain the reasoning for that again?
The reason was we did not feel that under, as a result of Alan's status as significant change agent in his first year and a half, it was felt that we needed to bypass the possibility of bias comments based on that change agent role.
But that could also be viewed as a really positive. I mean, there are a lot of positives that can come out of that. It sounds like you see that as a big negative, and that's why that was taken out.
I don't see it as a negative. We see it as a negative and decided to leave that out this year. Certainly, the board can override our recommendation.
I still have a question as to the actual actual tool that will be used by the board in assessing the superintendent, whether in the past there have been other formats used. I thought I've seen one. I went digging for it this afternoon and...
Well, there have been, I mean, I've got a huge stack of, you know, a file from past things that have been used to evaluate the superintendent, yeah. Mm. But just going back to, I mean, I think it's a great opportunity to get feedback from some of the staff, and I'd like to ask that to, I guess that goes to ask the committee to take that back and find a way to incorporate that into the evaluation process. I mean, I think people want to have a voice. And it's really important, I think, to give our entire learning community an opportunity to voice their feedback on our district's leader.
And based on the objection, I have no problem taking it back on behalf of the committee.
Well, and some of the discussion that took place that day, too, was that we also rely on our district leadership to go to their employees, obtain their opinions, and a lot of what they shared in their evaluation was not only their own personal appraisal of Alan to date, but also that of their staff, working with their staff on a daily basis. I can't believe any of our administrators out there didn't seek the opinions of the teachers and other staff members.
Yeah, I just think it's
their evaluation, and that was part of what we looked at, looking at some of the verbiage that they had, their comments that they had already provided to us, reflects not only their personal opinion, but that of others that work with them.
Yeah, I just don't think that we're going to get as full, a picture as if we, I mean, and again, I see this as a really positive opportunity. People, you know, welcome the opportunity to get feedback, and I would anticipate the bulk of it being positive. I mean, it's not as though people just love an opportunity to, you know, to voice their, you know, their what they feel about their leadership, and so it's, it's an opportunity for positive input.
And as I've already agreed to do, I'll be on behalf of the committee to take it back to the committee.
Specifically, which individuals are you looking at? Just going back to teachers, or are we talking about taking a cross-section from the principal, the senior administration, all the way down to, you know, whatever level? I guess that would be my question before taking it back to committee.
When we did this in the past, we went through all of our employees, their status as a teacher or an ed tech or a bus driver was all irrelevant. It was a random selection of one-third of the employees. I can't remember when the last time it was done, but then again, I can't remember the last time we had a real evaluation.
I not only see this as a good evaluation tool, but also as a really great kind of management tool as a way to kind of create a sense of ownership and participation in all the staff level. And I think we all know what kind of a environment we're working in, and we can filter comments through that. And I think just taking a random sample of the various levels would be, I think, just very informative as to what are on people's minds. Just as a school board member, I'd like to know what they're thinking about, what they value. It may not necessarily really be about the evaluation of the superintendent in the end, but more just as checking in with the staff. We don't very often get an opportunity to do this. And I would really support us moving forward with something like this. And to move back to my issue now, I don't necessarily have a problem with this format. I just would like to refamiliarize myself with some of the other options that have been used by the school board in terms of evaluating the superintendent. Although I'm also mindful that we don't have a lot of time either, so I'm not sure how we can kind of move this along so we can be in a position to do this before we lose some of our school board members in December.
I don't feel strongly enough about it one way or the other person. And what I'm looking around is I think I've heard from four people of the six board members here tonight that you'd like us to take another look at. And since I've been delegated, I suppose, the role of making that decision, I'm quite comfortable taking it back. Actually, you know, if you wanted to, you could vote on it and vote it down. So, you know, I can count.
When is the next personnel meeting? October 19th. If I think you've heard from a couple of the board members with some ideas, requests, if they could come forward, maybe we can still set a date, and over that time period,
set a date
for the evaluation, and then get some of those pieces in place, possibly for the board to consider. I had one other thing. I know that in the past also, and I don't see any suggestion here on how to handle this, but after we evaluated the superintendent in executive session, and Alan or the superintendent would be there for the evaluation and going over the goals and that type of discussion, we normally would come up with a report after our discussion. And that would be a discussion that would be without Alan after his presentation to us, in which we could report back to him on our thoughts, our discussion. And so I think there needs to be some sort of an assignment, whether the personnel committee is going to compile that or whether the board chair would do that as they have in the past. That's only my last comment that I don't see here.
And I recall having the meetings, mm-hmm. you know, solo meetings without the superintendent present.
Mm-hmm.
I can't for the life of me recall if we did anything with that material. So if that's your recollection, then, you know, pass it along to the entire committee.
Okay. Any other comments or ideas that you want to be expressed here before they go back?
So then what's the time frame going to be?
I think you should have your emails into Kathy with your suggestions by October 17th.
Well, what's the time frame that's been discussed?
Well, October 19th, they're meeting. So if
right,
there are any comments
that.
After that, we are going to.
December 31st.
My guess would be that we should have another business meeting to agree on the process and then schedule the actual evaluation after that business meeting. So it'd be mid to late November.
So it would have to be after November 14th,
mm-hmm.
but
before
December.
Whatever the date is.
Yeah, first, whatever. Okay. We'll come out with some possible dates between Alan and all school board members via email, and then we'll post that. But meanwhile, we know what personnel's doing and who needs to get in touch with whom. Thank you for the work on this, guys.
The other question, was everybody satisfied with Lisa Melanson's? I think it was Lisa Melanson.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Achievement Center. Achievement Center.
Yeah, the Achievement Center job. In that case, I would move that the school board adopt a job description for the Achievement Center.
Okay.
Second.
Thank you, Rebecca. Any other questions on that job description? Being none, all those in favor? 6-0. We have some committee reports, and we'll start with Finance Committee. Rebecca?
Sorry, yep, okay. We met on September 28th at 12 o'clock in the superintendent's office. Myself, Kathy Ray, Linda Winker, Alan Hawkins, Paulina Portria, Sue King, Ernie McVain, and Phil Coop of Smart Energy were present. We signed warrants, and then during the whole meeting, Phil Coop of Smart Energy reported to us his efforts to date to secure funding for alternative energy for the district. Unfortunately, to date, he has had little success in obtaining funding from foundations. He has learned that Smart Energy needs to reflect more experience working with renewable energy systems. Hence, he has started Energy Works, limited liability company, as a for-profit commercial and residential energy systems installation company. Mr. Coop has written a grant request for $4,600 from the Maine Community Foundation to purchase a Blue Link solar device for the middle and high schools. This device is basically a portable energy source. It's not very powerful, but it could power up a speaker system or something like that at a game. It's more as an, I would say, a PR tool than any sort of significant not necessarily going to have a significant impact on our energy use. Upon the recommendation of Ernie, the Finance Committee is recommending to the board that we pursue alternative energy systems in conjunction with the town as part of a community-wide committee involving citizens. And I believe that Phil is also very much on board with that. He feels as if he needs to reach out to, and he has reached out to the Land Trust, but also would like to reach out to CEF because of their experience with grant writing and fundraising, and other people who I think Cape Elizabeth is very motivated in the area of alternative energy. So we are going to be, Elaine and I are going to be meeting with the town council chairs in several weeks' time, and this will come up during our conversation. In addition to solar and wind energy, Ernie suggests that the town and school's alternative energy analysis include natural gas and thermal energy, which is all very interesting. I can't wait to tell you guys more about that, but it's fascinating. And I think he's really excited about some of the possibilities that are out there. He does not believe that biomass will work in Cape Elizabeth, mainly because of the pollution that it produces. The monthly energy report was reviewed. Because of the high school temperature control system is close to being fully operational, the district has already seen roughly $6,000 in electrical energy savings compared to last year. So, way to go, Ernie. There was no food service report to review this month, as September had not yet closed as of our meeting. The committee reviewed with Sue King high school lunch prices. Apparently, there's been some discussion in the community around this, and we reviewed the prices. Items that increased in price include coffee, Pop-Tarts, donuts, quesadillas, chicken nuggets, mainly because it's a larger size, and taquitos. Cold and hot sandwiches, soups, salads, daily specials, and orange juice prices remain the same. So, interestingly enough, most of the increases are in the unhealthy food, not as quite nutritional area, but the nutritional items have remained the same. Sue is up and running with breakfast in the middle school. She is serving an average of 16 to 20 breakfasts currently, and she's very happy with the way it's going, and she says the kids are really great, and looks forward to continuing to do this through the year.
The auditors released their annual report. One management issue that they cited is the requirement that federally funded staff must sign a form twice a year to confirm that they are fully funded by federal monies. The committee discussed the 07-08 budget process. Alan is beginning the process with district leadership discussions. He and Pauline will be more fully incorporating zero-based budgeting in the process and will prepare documents for use that outline the tools, schedule, and objectives. Alan and Pauline also are drafting a synopsis of the current state of the schools, including assessment results, five-year plan outreach efforts, and potential financial scenarios for 07-08. And our next meeting is set for October 24th at 12:30 in the in the superintendent's office. Are there any questions?
Great, thank you very much, Rebecca. Policy Committee, Ann.
Policy Committee met on September 19th. We first looked at an overview of each of the 12 sections and what is left to be done. I'd say there are probably approximately 50 to 60 policies left. And then, of course, once that's finished, hopefully, my guess would be by the end of this school year. That's perhaps
15 to 60.
that would be my goal. Then, of course, it'll just sort of start all over again. But anyway, also, some of those are going to be worked on in small groups. A few of us are going to start looking at the fundraising policies. Alan is going to meet with the DLT to look at some of the remaining C policies, which are general administration. Under old business, we got a couple of the policies ready for second reading, which we've already been through tonight. And under new business, of course, we did three policies that we've already presented this evening. In addition to those, we'll be discussing the pandemic policy down the road, and Alan attended a meeting on that. I'm sure we'll hear about that at our next policy committee meeting. Then I'll just move on to the wellness. Wellness committee met on October 3rd. That was the first meeting we'd had since the end of June. As many people know, we did do a survey that went out to all staff, parents, and students. And we had almost 650 surveys returned, of which approximately 450 were from students. A lot of those, the kids were asked to do those in their advisory classes or in grade school right there in their classes. So it was great to get student input. We had 65 staff return surveys and 112 parents. Interestingly enough, the bulk of those parents were high school parents. We only had a couple of Pond Cove parents return surveys. That kind of surprised us. We thought it would be the other way around, with parents of younger children having more investment in their diets. The surveys really brought us across the board in terms of feedback and attitudes. It's really all over the place in terms of how parents see the role of the schools in terms of nutrition and all that. So it was pretty interesting to look at those survey results. Steve Connolly has all of those, and so if anybody's interested, I'm sure they could contact you, Steve, is that okay, to look at those findings. And if I can just back up for a quick minute, for people who don't remember, the purpose of the Wellness Committee is to develop a wellness policy as mandated by the federal government, and so that's why we're doing all of this. In addition to that, we discussed policy EFE, which is competitive food sales, and what that has to do with is what can be sold during and after school hours outside of the lunch programs. Both Pond Cove and the middle school come under this policy. The high school does not because it doesn't offer the free lunch. And so it was decided that we will put forward in our recommended policy the five exceptions to the policy, which means that we will be recommending to the policy committee that foods are allowed to be sold at, you know, dances and games and so forth, with some guidelines in place. And I would say that's pretty much covers it. Thanks.
Any questions for Ann? Okay, moving forward to Communications Committee. Rebecca.
Well, we have scheduled our first meeting for October 25th at 3:10 in the Palm Cove Media Center. And I think one of the things that we'll put on our agenda is actually looking at how teachers can share results of professional development activities, because that came up this evening, and it really kind of put the bug in my ear that that would be a really great project for the Communications Committee.
Great. Kevin, are you going to make a report for personnel?
Yeah. Essentially, I'm going to just give you key points from our last meeting. Dominic is reviewing EdTech job descriptions for the special ed staff. I believe I heard Alan say that that's done and will be coming to us for our review at the next meeting. The teacher job leader description is written, and Paulie, what we did was make a very conscious decision that all of these job descriptions would follow a standard format. So Pauline is putting that in. If I know Pauline, it's already done. So I guess that might will be back as well. Alan and staff are working on a central file for all applications for all employees, which will be in the central office and not scattered throughout the system. And the other issue is to be looking into the situation with coaches to make sure we actually have applications and they've met the guidelines for fingerprints and whatever background checks are required for those working with students. New employment applications, that's the Allen and staff again, that's due next spring. We already reviewed the Achievement Center and Food Service Director. Food Service Director is going back. Pauline is summarizing all job descriptions that we still don't have in place so we can get that fully completed. Alan has, let's see, EdTechs. For EdTechs, evaluation forms will be somewhat different depending upon the different job requirements, i.e. the difference between the 1, 2, and 3 designations, as well as the difference between the regular EdTechs and the special EdTechs. Let's see. I think that's, let's see, regarding the superintendent's performance appraisal, Alan submitted to the committee an evaluation form from May 2006. Form is designed to be used by the board as well as the administrators. The administrators can also poll their respective employees for additional comments, which is the conversation we just had. The committee approved the form for Alan's next performance appraisal to be sent to the full board, which it has been and is going back. So the next meeting, October 19th, 12:30 p.m., Jordan Conference Room.
Thank you, Kevin. Strategic planning, Trish.
We have not met since our last board meeting. We have a meeting scheduled for Monday, October 16th, which at 1 p.m. in the superintendent's office, and I'm assuming we'll hear an update on some of the planning that's gone on for our community discussion.
What was the time again?
1 p.m.
Okay. Student Extracurriculum Committee. Back to Kevin.
Yeah, we met, well, I shouldn't say we. Most of the committee met on September 19th. I, as well as Linda, were unable to attend because of personal issues. And Scott Labby was unable to attend because he had a game to see to. Alan was kind enough to take over the meeting for the day. There was sports done right. Sue Weatherby and Leslie Young went up for the Sports Done Right conference on September 25th. will be getting a report back from both of them at our next meeting on the 17th, I believe. There's also a Sports Done Right philosophy self-evaluation that Sue completed, as did Scott and Keith, and the results show that programs run and supervised by the school department meet and or exceed the standard. This type of assessment has not been done before, and it is separate from school, done on programs, separate from the school programs, but the information will be valuable. This and other aspects of Sport Done Right program will be extended after the September meeting and follow-up discussions. There is another Sports Done Right conference on December 11th, and depending upon what happens on November 7th, I plan on going, as I believe Alan, will you be going as
That's
well?
That's my plan, yeah.
And there's, okay, now it works. And there's also, you know, availability for other board members and faculty if they should choose to go along. Policies, there are a whole pile of policies that we've begun to review. I've suggested that we put all the booster related policies under a subgroup for review. We have a new packet of brand new suggested policies from the Maine School Management Association, which we'll be comparing directly to what's already on our books and seeing if they're appropriate to our particular situation. In any event, we hope to start pumping them out to policy shortly. There's a proposed agenda for October 17th, Sports Done Right by Sue Weatherby, a report, a review of current policies, language discussions, appropriate new policy suggestions from MSMA samples, process to review and submit to the policy committee, an update on the kids' turf plan, what's happening there, and we will also be entertaining a request for a sailing club to be given club status so that it can compete under the Cape Elizabeth name. I believe I've already circulated the proposal to everyone. There will be some representatives there. If any of you have questions and would care to attend and ask them, that's fine. As an alternative, you can email your questions to any member of the Extracurricular Activities Committee. Our next meeting is October 17th at 2:15 p.m. That's it.
I'm just looking at the schedule here. These both say for policy and student extracurricular October 12th, but I think they are the 17th.
They're the 17th?
Yeah.
I changed. I made a correction.
Okay. Okay.
I'm We've sorry. Got the 17th.
Okay. Okay. Mine says the 12th, so I wasn't sure.
Okay, now I understand.
Okay. Yeah.
I gave everyone a new one, but it wasn't necessary.
So when I read the dates, we'll get them clear.
Because I realize it.
At this point, we have public comment.
We have this one.